is John Daly with the Imperial Army of Alexander of Macedon at the Hippasus River in northern India. This day in the 113th Olympiad, Nacy battled between the Greek and Persian divisions of Alexander's forces, with the supreme commander leading the Persian unit against his own Greek countrymen. For 3 days, Alexander's Greeks have defied his orders to go forward into the dangerous lands of India to the east. They insist on returning to Greece. Today, Alexander has called an assembly of the Greek units. It is expected that he will offer his countrymen one last chance to end their mutiny. If they refuse, it's believed that Alexander will order the Persians to attack at once. It must be emphasized, however, that this is not official. It is speculation. The best opinion we've been able to obtain in answer to our
question, why Alexander ordered the Greek troops. India, you are there.
Alexander of Macedon, seeking mastery of the world, is defied by his war-weary Greek troops. CBS takes you back more than 2,000 years to the climax in the career of the great conqueror. All things are as they were then, except for one thing. When CBS is there,
you are there.
You Are There, produced and directed by Robert Louis Cheyenne, is based on authentic historical fact and quotation. Today's broadcast, Mutiny in India, is the last of a trilogy on the life of Alexander the Great. And now,
India, the army of Alexander and John Daly.
Alexander will order the Persians to attack them. That is the expectation here on the assembly ground near the Hippasus River, where the Greek troops are falling in to hear Alexander. There are, of course, only 30,000 Greeks in Alexander's imperial expeditionary forces against 100,000 Persians. Persian troops are comparatively fresh, but the Greeks are war-weary. They had hoped that after their young king had crossed into Asia, reached the borders of India, the easternmost boundary of his empire, he would turn homeward. But Alexander led the army into India, into lands never before entered by civilized men. When the troops reached their present position here on the west bank of the Hippasus River, Greek resentment reached the point of mutiny. The Greek divisions held conferences, sent a delegation to Alexander demanding that he turn back. The emperor rejected that demand, ordered the Persian divisions to prepare for an attack upon the Greeks. But then, instead of attacking today as was expected, Alexander ordered disassembly of the Greek units. Alexander is still at his headquarters and probably will not appear here until the assembly is completed. But General Coenus, the leader of the insurgent Greek divisions, has arrived. Is at our news headquarters a short distance away. Ned Kalmer is with him, so go ahead, Ned Kalmer.
General Coenus will be with us in a moment. He's speaking to several officers. The general is of middle age, slightly above medium height, and there's a scar on his face, the mark of an old sword wound, a scar running from his left ear down to his lip. Coenus has been one of Alexander's most reliable captains, and the general has ended his conversation with the officers, and he's coming this way. General Coenus, sir. Do you think Alexander has called this assembly to give the Greeks an ultimatum?
Yes, he'll stand on that platform. He'll rage and threaten, but that will change nothing. The troops will stand fast. Alexander must yield. He must end this expedition and lead us back to Greece.
But, General, I'm afraid a good many officers disagree with you, sir. They think that unless you end the mutiny, Alexander will order the Persians to attack.
Persians? That's merely frightened talk. Disregard it. The Emperor's threat to use the Persians against us is a sham.
Oh, what's your reasoning on that, sir?
If the Emperor throws the Persians against us, he'll not only destroy us, but himself as well.
Himself?
Do you think those Persians have forgotten that Alexander invaded their country and conquered them? Do you think they've forgotten that their kinsmen died on the battlefields of Granicus, Issus, and the Tigris? No, sir. The Persians have no love for Alexander. Once we Greeks were gone, they would turn on Alexander like wolves.
Well, General, suppose you're mistaken. Supposing Alexander does throw the Persians against you, what are your chances to defeat them?
He won't. He can't. But if he does, we have no chance at all.
But you Greeks have always been outnumbered by the Persians when you fought them, and yet you've beaten them.
Yes, but always in the past, Alexander was our general. If we fight today, he will be leading the enemy. And as a general, he has no equal. He's worth 500,000 men.
And still, sir, in spite of that, you're willing to risk a battle?
We have no choice. We Greeks have been campaigning with Alexander for 9 years. We fought countless battles. We've seen our comrades die. And we feared each battle would be our last. These past 60 days, we've marched through a wilderness infested with poisonous reptiles. It's rained every day. Hundreds have perished of snake bite and fevers, and what lies ahead? Only more fighting against the Gangadi, a great and savage nation. What difference does it make if we die today or the next day? If we must die, rather than die fighting for Alexander's insane ambition, let us die fighting to go home.
Thank you, General Koenig. And now Don Hollenbeck at Alexander's headquarters is waiting to report. So over to him. Go ahead, Don Hollenbeck.
The Emperor has still not left to go to the Greek assembly ground. Here outside Alexander's headquarters, the 100,000 men of the Persian units are drawn up behind Alexander's tent. Near the headquarters are 1,000 Persian cavalrymen, the royal bodyguard. Ordinarily, the Emperor's bodyguard is composed of an equal number of Greeks and Persians, but all the Greeks were instantly dismissed when the mutiny began. Among the royal bodyguard are a number of Persian satraps, warlords. The commander of the bodyguard is Oxiates, king of Sogdia, the emperor's father-in-law. Alexander married Oxiates' daughter Roxanne 2 years ago, and thereby cementing the friendship between this Persian warlord and his Greek ruler. King Oxiates has agreed to a brief interview. He's with us now. Your Highness, General Koenig, the leader of the insurgents, said a moment ago that Alexander is coming to the assembly ground prepared to yield to the Greek troops. Do you think that's true?
Does the tiger yield to the fawn? Does the eagle yield to the dove? Does the leviathan yield to the minnow?
Well, from your metaphors, I conclude you think Alexander will not yield.
I am not privy to the emperor's thoughts in this matter. But it is my belief that unless the Greek troops throw off their misleaders and submit voluntarily, Alexander will scourge them into submission.
Well, do you think the Greek troops will break and submit?
Does it matter to the tempest if the trees bend before it? Does it matter to the sea if the shore crumbles? Does it matter to heaven if the earth vanishes? Alexander belongs no longer to Greece. His majesty belongs to the world. And with or without the Greeks, he will go on to conquer the world. We Persians will march with him.
But the Gangaridi who lie ahead are reported to be very strong. It's said they have 2,000 war chariots, 20,000 cavalry, 200,000 infantry, and 3,000 war elephants.
Possibly. But our spies also report that the Gangaridi are dissatisfied with their present king. He is said to be a mere father, elevated to the throne by an amorous queen. The Gangaridi will not fight for him. They will welcome Alexander as a liberator.
Your Highness, General Koenig claims if the Greek units were destroyed, you Persians would then turn on Alexander and destroy him. Would you comment on that?
I shall be delighted. Alexander has enlarged my kingdom fivefold. He has married my daughter. She will bear him sons, who will one day reign in his place on the high throne of Asia. Does a father murder a beloved son? Does a vassal murder the ruler he honors? Does the receiver of rich gifts murder his benefactor?
Excuse me, Your Highness. Alexander has come out of his tent. He wears battle dress. He's made some significant changes in his armor. In the past, Alexander's armor has been a mixture of Greek and Persian design, symbolizing the unity of both peoples. But today, the emperor's battle dress is Persian from helmet to boot. The emperor looks weary, older than his 33 years. His face reflects the strain he's been under these 3 days of the Greek mutiny. Alexander and King Oxiates and the other Persian satraps have mounted now. Behind them, the thousands. The trumpets are sounding. Alexander spurs his charges forward. The cavalrymen dig into the flanks of their mounts, and behind the cavalry, the entire Persian force begins to move. Alexander's riding to the assembly ground with all the Persian divisions behind him, so back to John Daly with the Greek troops. Go ahead, John Daly.
From our position here at the assembly ground, we can see Alexander and the vanguard of the Persians coming over the crest of a hill about half a mile away. They're riding at gallop, raising a heavy cloud of dust as they approach. The Greek troops here are watching their king approach. They're silent, resolute, seem ready for anything. The veterans of Alexander's campaigns are standing rank upon rank, 30,000 of them, drawn up by divisions. To my left, the famous companion cavalry, the spearhead of all Alexander's victories. Next to them, the phalanx, Alexander's mighty hammer, which has shattered every enemy line Alexander has met in 9 years of victorious campaign. To the right, the light-armed foot soldiers, the most mobile and highly disciplined body of troops in the world. All these men show signs of the hard campaigning they've undergone, especially these past 2 years since the invasion of India. Alexander's bodyguard has halted now at the edge of the field. Behind the bodyguard, the Persian divisions are also coming to a rest. But Alexander alone continues to ride on toward this platform through the ranks of the Greek troops. But the Greeks do not salute their commander and king. They hold him accountable for their suffering. The men are bone thin, wasted by hunger and disease. Their armor is dented and rusty. Many of them have festering wounds. The king of Macedon has reined up before the platform. Quickly, he dismounts without a word to anyone. Without a glance at General Coenus, he's mounting the steps of the platform from which he will speak. A lone figure before the 30,000 silently accusing and defiant Greeks who must be wondering whether their emperor will actually hurl the Persians against them unless they end their mutiny. Alexander is speaking.
3 days ago, your spokesman informed me that you refused to continue the campaign beyond the Hippasus River. Soldiers of Greece, this is treason! I should have nailed your spokesman to the nearest trees, flogged thousands into obedience, cut off hundreds of heads, as I did twice before, when traitors dared to rebel against me. Philotas, Callisthenes, Parmenion, all traitors and all dead. Yet, out of my love for you, my fellow countrymen, my simple soldiers who shared danger with me and victory, I am showing the greatest of forbearance. Soldiers of Greece, there are limits to my patience. We go forward, forward against the Gangrenes, forward to new and ever more glorious victories, forward to mastery of the world.
Alexander's words have drawn no response from the Greek divisions. The men are absolutely silent, unmoved by the eloquence of their king. They've heard his eloquence before, and apparently they... General Coenus is mounting the platform. Alexander turns to him. Coenus confronts his king. Now, back to the platform.
When you charge us with treason, we have opposed your will, but only because it has become necessary to place a limit upon our suffering.
Your suffering. Have not I, your emperor, suffered as painfully as the commonest soldier?
True, sire, but you must realize how numerous we Greeks were 9 years ago when you marched forth from Macedon on this expedition. You must realize, sire, how few of our original numbers have survived.
Aye, and you who have survived have sacks of gold and precious jewels.
Oh, when I became your king, you were peasants living in mud huts. Now you are men of wealth and power. I have made you princes of Asia. But we are men, sire. We have a great yearning to see our wives and children. Of what use is gold to us if we die here on an alien soil? Lead us. Lead us, we beg you, back to Greece. Then, if it be your wish, lead a new expedition against the Gangrene. Young men will flock to your banner, replacing us who have grown old and weak in battle and hardship much. Us at what? Or by my father Zeus, the Persians attack. I beseech you, sire, trust not the Persians. You rule their bodies, but not their hearts. Trust us, sire, us, the loyal Greeks, we who honor and love you.
Fool!
Mortal! It is I, Alexander, Emperor of Asia, son of the divine Zeus Ammon, a demigod who speaks. Forward, I say, forward, O sire! No!
The emperor is leaving the platform, his face pale with rage. General Coenus has just ordered the Greeks to prepare to resist an attack. Should Alexander order it now? The king has mounted. He's riding towards the Persians. The men are turning to face the Persian divisions. Cavalrymen are setting their lances, archers fitting arrows to their bows. Soldiers of the phalanx have locked shields and raised their long spears. Others have drawn their swords. The Persians haven't moved. two jets. Alexander is approaching them, and a horseman has left the Persian rank and has met Alexander in the center of the field. The horseman is Alexander of Tomisus, the emperor's chief soothsayer. He's talking excitedly with Alexander. The emperor shakes his head, and there is evidently an area of disagreement. This unexpected development comes as a complete surprise. We don't know what it means. Alexander is one of the most celebrated augurs in the world. The two men are galloping back here towards the platform, and General Coenus has ordered to stop the preparations for battle. We don't know if they present some startling development. Alexander is the great magician and soothsayer, famous seer and diviner of the will of the gods. He is Alexander's chief augur, entrusted with the making of sacrifices, examining the omens and reading them. On the basis of the omens, he very often advises Alexander on difficult decisions. The emperor has dismounted now at the platform. Alexander remains below. The men are silent again. General Coenus and the Greek unit seem to know nothing more than we do about the meaning of this unexpected development. Alexander is up on the platform again. Ignores General Coenus, and once more Alexander speaks to the troops.
The soothsayer Alexander has intervened in your behalf. He wishes to demonstrate to you that it is not my will, but the will of the gods that we go forward. Here, now, on this platform, before your very eyes, Alexander shall perform the ceremony of the omen. He shall reveal to you the will of the son of Zeus, the friend and counselor of mankind, the Olympian Apollo. By what omen, sire, shall the will of Apollo be revealed? By the flight of a sacred white falcon. When the bird, upon release from its cage, flies eastward, it shall be a sign that you must march eastward. But, sire, what if the bird does not fly eastward? What if it flies to the west, the south, or the north? The falcon shall fly east, you hear? What if it does not fly east, sire?
Why not, sir?
If the bird fly in any direction but east, we march home. You swear it, sire. I swear it. Alexander, prepare the ceremony.
Alexander is leaving the platform. General Coenus is following. The Greek troops have broken ranks, are milling about the field, talking excitedly about this new development. For the moment, at least, there will be no battle here. Ned Kalmer has made his way to General Coenus, who is surrounded by a group of excited Greek officers. So go ahead, Ned Kalmer.
General Coenus, what do you think of the emperor's decision to learn the will of Apollo in the flight of a falcon?
Alexander has yielded. He's broken, just as I said he would. We're going home. Home to Greece.
Home? I don't understand, General. Isn't that question still to be decided by the flight of the falcon?
No, the question's already decided. The falcon will fly west.
West? How do you know that, sir?
Because Alexander has instructed the soothsayer to make the falcon fly west.
Are you charging that the ceremony of the omens is a fraud?
Of course it's a fraud, a device to permit the emperor to yield without loss of prestige. Instead of humbling himself before his men, he will make it appear as if he is accepting the will of Apollo in the matter.
But can the flight of a falcon be predetermined?
My dear fellow, it's the simplest thing in the world. That rascal Alexander is a clever trickster. He has dozens of white sacred falcons in his cages. Why, they're all trained to fly in different directions. Some to the west, some to the east, and so forth. I'm a member of Alexander's staff. I've seen it done before. I told you this would happen. Alexander has realized at last that without his Greek divisions, he cannot conquer anything. Without us, he could not even hold the throne of Asia. Without the consent and support of loyal troops, even an emperor is nothing.
Thank you, General Coenus. And now I'm informed that Don Hollenbeck, who's with Alexander in the Persian divisions at the edge of the assembly grounds, is ready with a report on the Persian point of view on this matter. So over to him. Go ahead, Don Hollenbeck.
I'm in a tent that's been hastily put up here to shade Alexander and his Persian satraps while they await the ceremony of the omens. Alexander is talking to members of his royal bodyguard. But here with us again is General Oxiotes. Your Highness, General Coenus has just said the ceremony of the omens will be a fraud. He says that Alexander will direct the flight of the sacred falcon and that the bird will fly west, signifying Alexander's capitulation to the will of the Greeks. What's your comment on that?
I am not a Greek. I know nothing of their gods or their ceremonies. But I do know my son-in-law. Alexander has not approached so close to his majestic goal of world domination, only to be stopped now by a handful of miserable Greeks.
But, Your Highness, if Alexander means to continue the expedition, why has he offered the ceremony of the omens he could have attacked?
Alexander is not only shrewd, he is also merciful. If Greeks are to die this day, he wishes to sacrifice as few of his countrymen as possible. Therefore, he plays upon their superstition. He knows that when the falcon flies east, many Greek soldiers will accept it as the will of Apollo and capitulate.
You say the falcon will fly east, and you also think the ceremony will be a fraud.
Well, let us not call it a fraud. It is a wise stratagem. We Persians worship the god who rides the blazing sun chariot across the heavens, the supreme Ahura Mazda. But even among us, however, kings have been known to instruct the Magi to, shall we say, assist our god in determining what mortals should do. Do not believe General Coenus. The expedition goes on.
Thank you, King Oxiates. And now John Daly reports that the ceremony of the omens has begun, so back to the platform. Go ahead, John Daly.
Up there on the platform, the ceremony of the omens has begun with an invocation by a chorus of 12 Greek boys. The chorus is chanting the hymn of Apollo, which begins with the words, "We will sing in praise of thee, glorious son of Zeus, who dwellest on the snowy peak, where in sacred oracles thou hast proclaimed tidings prophetic from the divine tripodic seat." Alexander the soothsayer stands at the center of the platform, wears a white robe girded about the waist by a belt of hammered gold. On his brow, the soothsayer wears a finely wrought chaplet, also of gold. The chanting boys are dressed in white tunics and short white skirts. Their invocation is accompanied by the music of a flute and a lyre, and on a high tripod, in full view of the troops, is the instrument that will reveal the will of Apollo and the fate of this expedition, a large cage which contains a white falcon. Alexander still hasn't arrived, so let's listen to the hymn for a moment. Among the 30,000 Greek soldiers here is watching its flight, taut nerves at the snapping point. The falcon is soaring in wide circles directly overhead, and it seems to be searching for its course. And now, with another scream, the falcon is winging westward. It's flying west in the direction of Greece. And to a man, every Greek has turned to Alexander on the platform. The bird has flown west, but will Alexander keep his promise? The king is still watching the falcon. As it grows smaller and smaller in the distance, there's an expression of bitter heartbreak, sorrow on his face.
Soldiers,
now the king is speaking.
Of Greece, Apollo has spoken.
No mortal, not even I, Alexander, a demigod, may defy him. Soldiers of Greece, we march home.
India. Alexander of Macedon submits to his war-weary Greek troops and fails to realize his goal of world conquest.
Footnote. Alexander did not lead his Macedonian troops back to Greece. He took them as far west as Persia. And there, 3 years later, 323 B.C., Alexander caught the fever and died. You have been listening to Mutiny in India, another broadcast in the series You Are There, produced and directed by Robert Louis Cheyenne. Mutiny in India was written by Michael Sklar. It was the last of a trilogy, Alexander the Great Seeks Mastery of the World. Alexander was played by Richard Waring. General Coenus was Torrin Thatcher. King Oxiates by David Oreck, and the Soothsayer by Guy Sorrell. Next week,
April 22nd, 1889, the Oklahoma land run. You are there.
Fine comedy, fine drama on the distaff side are provided every Sunday night by two of America's most talented actresses, Miss Eve Arden and Miss Helen Hayes. Every week, Miss Hayes is heard on the Electric Theater in an outstanding Broadway motion picture or radio drama, while Miss Arden brings you the lighter side of a teacher's troubles as the star of Our Miss Brooks. CBS cordially invites you to hear them both every Sunday night over most of these same stations. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.